Okay, so welcome everyone back. Thank you very much, Hiraku, for joining us so early. And today, we are very happy to have Hiraku Nakajima from IPMU, who is going to tell us about geometric satake for affine Lie algebras. Thank you again for joining, and please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much for invitation. So I gave a link to my note. So this is shared in Dropbox, and it is automatically updated in every 1 minute. So if you go, well, if you like to see the earlier notes, then you just go to this website, and occasionally you should reload the file in order to update. Okay, anyways, I will talk about the geometric satake for affine algebras. So I first review the conjecture, which is proposed by Braverman-Finkelberg in 2007. So this is a geometric satake for affine Lie algebra. But then next I go back to the finite dimensional case, and I will explain the result work of Ginzburg-Riche in 2004. So they compare the affine glass Manion and cotangent bundle of the Langrand's dual flag variety. So they have some kind of construction, or topological construction of cotangent bundle to the flag variety via affine glass Manion. So I will explain this result. Then next I will explain our result of Ginzburg-Riche. So still it's finite dimensional. So they reformulate the result of Ginzburg in more algebraic terms. And they also observe that there is a quantum version in the affine glass Manion side, equals in the loop rotation. And in the cotangent flag side, so instead of cotangent bound, they consider the its quantization. This is given by universal Braverman module. Then after these preparations, somehow I hope you can understand what is the main result. So main result is just generate the affine Katsumudi version of the Ginzburg-Riche. So Ginzburg-Riche was finite dimensional setting, but you can, after geometric satake is properly formulated for affine Lie algebra, then somehow automatically you can understand what should be the correct formulation for the Ginzburg-Riche in the affine setting. And then the proof goes in very much similar to the Ginzburg-Riche's approach. And one new feature is just how to deal with imaginary root. And otherwise, the approach is very much the same. Okay, and this is a joint work in progress with Dinakar Muthiah. Okay, anyway, so please interrupt me if you have any questions. Okay. So let that start with Braverman-Finkelberg conjecture. So historically they use the instanton moduli space, but somehow after the introduction of Coulomb, it's much easier to explain in terms of those. So I start with Coulomb branch. So this is a quiver. And I assume this is without edge loops. And in fact, in order to consider the non-symmetric Katsumudi, I need to also consider valued quiver. But this is something technical. I just explained. I just mentioned that all the construction which I explained has a generation for symmetrizable case, non-symmetric case, and in that case, I need to consider valued quiver. So anyway, so for valued quiver, so you can introduce symmetrizable Katsumudi Lie algebra. And so for for notational convenience, I write this by G-check, and I denote its Lagrange there by just G without check. And I take V and W, so this is Q0 graded vector space. And lambda is weights, dominant weight. So this is a weight of G. So it's the weight co-weight of G check. So this is another weight. Then Braverman-Finkelberg and myself introduced Coulomb branch. Well, I mean, of course, physicists introduced Coulomb branch area, and we introduced a mathematical definition of the Coulomb branch. So I don't want to go into the detail of the definition of the Coulomb branch. Of course, since 2016, I have been giving talking about Coulomb branch many times. So most of you already heard about it. So anyway, so from those quivers, we introduce group G, and so this is just the product of general linear group and some representation. So if you know the definition of quiver, it's just use the same amount of data, but instead of simple elliptic vectors, you just take its Lagrangian subspace. And then you introduce affine Grassmannian G. And then you introduce R. So this is what we call variety of triples. So this is affine Grassmannian is G of K divided by G of K. It's formal Laurent power series, and O is formal power series. So this is a subvariety. Here, G of G and S of G. And we impose a condition. So this is regular. And you have an action of G of O on this space. And you consider the convolution algebra given by equivariant cohomology. Equivalent homology, Borel-Moore homology. Then it is an algebra, and in this situation, it's remarkably so. This becomes commutative. So this is very unlikely for the convolution algebra, but because of this very special situation, so this becomes commutative, and then I take spectrum. So this is a very general construction for any given complex reductive group, and its representation you can define a Coulomb branch in the same way, but I consider that the special case for the, those G and N arising from quivers. Okay, then this is something to do with Satake, geometric Satake, because the following result. So this is also joint work with Braverman-Finkelberg. So if Q is finite type, finite, I mean AD, BFD, BHFD, finite type. Oh, maybe I should say that this is the original definition, and also for the valued case, this is a joint work this week. And suppose mu is dominant. Then this Coulomb branch, MC of lambda mu, is sliced in the affine class 9. So I had you heard about affine Grassmannian slices in last week, so I don't need to explain too much about it. But this affine Grassmannian is nothing to do with this affine Grassmannian feature used in the definition of Coulomb. So this is affine Grassmannian for G. So I introduce the real algebra. Sorry, this is G check. I introduce the algebra G check, and I consider the corresponding adjoint type group, and I consider the corresponding affine class. So in this affine class mining, so there's an orbit corresponding to lambda. So lambda is a weight of G check. G, so this is a co-weight of G check. I take the closure. And inside this closure, you have the smaller orbit, which is Grassmannian. And the, so this is the picture. So this is. And then you take slice like this. This intersection, which I didn't see of me. This is a torus fixed point. And this red is the slice, the picture for the slice. And this variety appears in geometric, this appears in the usual geometric. And also it is known that this MC lambda mu is also known to be. Moduli space of singular monopole. And so lambda and mu corresponding to the type of singularity at the origin. Lambda is the type of singularities, and mu is a monodomial. So anyways, you have this kind of space. And so this affine case, so it is expected. Unfortunately, we don't have the full proof yet, but it is expected that this MC lambda. So this is a natural generalization model of a singular monopole. So this is a moduli space. Instantons. R4 divided by G mod L finite cyclic group. And this L is level of lambda, the weight down, affine weight down lambda. Also it is equal to the level of mu. And so both, for both cases, the gauge group is given by the type of quiver. Okay. And as I mentioned, in the original formulation of Braverman-Finkelberg in 2007. So they used, so at that time there was no definition of Coulomb branch in general. So they used this description. Well, so they proposed to consider modular space in instanton. Okay. So until this is proved. Well, affine type A in my joint work with Takayama. So anyway, as I mentioned, because this slice is in affine Grassmannian appears in the usual geometry, Satake, so Braverman-Finkelberg proposed geometric Satake form. Affine algebra using this thing. And even further, I mean, this Coulomb branch doesn't make sense even beyond the affine algebra. So for any symmetrizable Katsumi algebra. So we update the conjecture. So this should hold for any symmetrizable Katsumi. Okay, let me make a little bit more precise. So I consider the inclusion G mu of incident. So I denote this inclusion by A of mu. So I introduced the G of mu for the case of affine Grassmannian slices, but this point is very distinct point in the Coulomb branch. So this is unique, fixed, unique. So T fixed point. So maybe I should also say that there's an action, torus action on this Coulomb branch. So this is coming from the first you consider. So I start with the product of general linear group, and I take the fundamental group, and it's one Pontryagin theorem. So pi one of G is a product of infinite cyclic group, and it's one Pontryagin dual is the torus, and from the construction, it naturally acts on the Coulomb branch. And so maybe I should say this unique T fixed point in C, if fixed point, if exist. So there's a case when there's no fixed point at all. Maybe if you are familiar, this geometric circle, so maybe you are confused, but if mu is not the weight of corresponding representation for highest weight lambda, then MC lambda mu doesn't have a fixed torus fixed point. MC lambda mu is always non-empty. So I impose a condition here. So when mu is dominant, MC lambda is sliced, but in general, so this MC lambda mu makes sense even without dominance condition. And even mu is not weight of corresponding representation. So this space could be non-empty. It's always non-empty, but fixed point is empty. So this is some technical complications of But anyway, so I just mentioned. And I, from now, I implicitly assume that there's a fixed point. I don't care the space which doesn't have t fixed. So anyway, so then I consider the intersection cohomology complex. Associated with a trivial local system. So this is a shorthanded notation. Let's see. IC of MC lambda. So this is as usual in the geometric Satake. So then the conjecture is stated in following way. So first is, so you consider the cost of at this fixed point. And the usual setting, this is a isomorphic to global intersection cohomology up to shift. So this vanish in order degree. And the second, so we are characteristic. So this, since this vanishes in all degrees, so the Euler characteristic is equal to the total dimension. So this is weight multiplicity. So this is the dimension of weight space. So this is the integrable highest weight. So V lambda is, so this is the integrable highest weight module. Okay. Highest representation with highest weight lambda, and V mu lambda is its weight space. And the third claim is tensor product. It's given by convolution product. So since this part is not so relevant in my talk, so I will not mention further. But so in the last week, so you heard about this. So I don't go further. Okay, so this is the connection between this topology and representation theory, and it's well known in the finite setting, starting from the work of Brylinski-Kostant, and many people contributed to Markowitz, Pironen, Ginzburg, and various and others. And so if you're not familiar with the intersection cohomology, so you can also consider, so in type A, affine type A also, MC lambda mu has a symplectic resolution. Then you consider the, so maybe this is it. So MC lambda. So this coming from the flavor symmetry. So this is simple resolution. And in this case, one can also consider. So I denote this by pi. One can also consider. And there is distinguished point. So you can also consider the Borel-Mumbai homology of by inverse of z mu. So this is a Lagrangian sum, right? So instead of cost of intersection cohomology complex, you can also consider this. So this correspond instead of integral highest weight differentiation, you should consider in this case the tensor product of level one modulus. But that's the only difference. And still, I mean, the question still, the conjecture still makes sense. And also, what I will talk about from now also makes sense for this. And the question also makes sense. Okay, this is a geometric Satake for affine reagents. Any question? Okay, let's go on. So in 2008, so I checked this for affine type A. So I use the following. So MC.
Sorry, I apologize. So so you say it's smooth in affine type A. It has its implicative resolution. In any other cases for affine?
I mean, of course, some trivial case, very small case it is, but in practice, almost all the case, there is no symplectic resolution. So it contains, for example, the minimal nilpotent orbit as instant modulus space, So this doesn't, it is well known that they don't have symplectic resolution.
So in finite type, there for minuscule representations, right? You always have symplectic
resolution. Well, yeah. But
is there some such an analog of this for with the fine nodes as well, or?
There's a larger flavor symmetry in affine type A because there is a cycle in the quiver. So we use this, and the minuscule is not enough. So this is very special in affine type A. So there, for other graphs, there's no cycles. There's no flavor symmetry other than the usual one given by tensor product. Okay. I'm in the middle of explaining my result. So MC is a quiver variety. So in general, rank and level interchanged. And so this quiver variety is also known to be related to the representation set theory of affine algebra, of different affine algebra, but those two affine algebra are related by Finkel level rank duality. So this is the first hand use Finkel's level rank duality. Okay, maybe I should mention that in the quiver variety side, the corresponding statement is a finiteness of the torus fixed points. And for affine type A, if you just consider the action, torus action acting from on the framing, so it's not enough because you get the Hilbert, just the product of Hilbert scheme of points on the type A singularities. Then you further introduce extra cyst action coming from this cycle, then it's parameterized by Young diagram, it becomes finite. So, but this is very typical. It's true only in type A, and if you don't consider type D or E, then there's no such extra cyst action. So there's fixed point, torus fixed points are not isolated. So this is very typical in alpha, only in type A. Okay, then,
What is Frankel's level rank duality?
So this is, I mean, of course, I don't know the GL, L affine and SL N. So level N, level R. So there's some relation between the, so if you consider GL, L times N affine reagent, and they are commutant in natural sense. And you can, as in the sure wild duality, you can define a functor from affine algebra for GLL to affine algebra SLN, and you can say quite a lot about it. For example, so the most relevant is this weight multiplicity in the one of the reagent SLN hat can be explained, can is equal to the tensor product multiplicity in the other side. So this factor I used. And also, I mean, this is compatible with 3D mirror symmetry. So this, the quiver variety is Higgs branch, and this is Coulomb branch, but you can swap, somehow change the quivers, and you can realize quiver variety as a Coulomb. So this happens here, and that is compatible with level language.
So in this case, say level n for GLR will be the rank of each node of the quiver, right? And then it will
maybe I make mistakes. This is level L.
L, right.
This is equal to this one, and this n is equal to this rank.
Yeah, I understand.
So in terms of Young diagram, so this is a transport. This is different Frankel, so this is equal Frankel. Okay. Next I explain one remaining statement. So this was not proved in my paper. So this is about a Poincaré polynomial. So I denote P lambda Q. So again, I consider the Kostok, and so this is because this is a cohomology. So this has grading, and in the second statement, I just ignore this grading, but you just remember. So this is a finite information. And so Braverman-Finkelberg explained, so what is a different representation, theoretical meaning of this grading. And if Q is finite type, this is known. So this is a loose thing. So this P lambda mu Q is equal to C lambda mu Q. So this is a some combinatorial polynomial. Given in terms of constant partition function. Constant. Now this is not, constant is a mathematician. It's not a partition function in physical sense. It's a partition as those appear in detail. So anyway, so there's some I don't want to go into detail. So this is some combinatorial object which gives some polynomial, and this is also related to whole with all the polynomial. And the heuristic computed this Poincaré polynomial and find that this is given by this combination object. And moreover, so this combinatorial object, C lambda mu Q, it's given by the following. So this F is the so-called Brylinski-Kostant filtration. So this is some filtration defined on representation. So maybe this result is Brylinski, Blair, and Ginzburg. So this is defined like this. You consider the representation, highest weight representation, and you consider E. So this E is the principal nilpotent. Principal nilpotent.
These Lustig Poincaré polynomials, could you get them as Euler characters of homes between some line bundles or sheaves on
I would explain. So this is given by cotangent the flag variety, Langlands-Neel flag variety.
But not on the original intersection of slices.
Well, that is the Poincaré polynomial.
Okay.
So this is the finite information. So if you just consider the Euler characteristic, then it is given by the weight multiplicity. And so this, if I remember the cohomological degree, this is finite information. And if you set Q equal one, then this is equal to the weight multiplicity.
Yeah, no, so I think I would have liked it to be some kind of equivariant or other characteristic of some sort.
I will explain experiment intersection cohomology, but that plays a different role. So maybe the simplest case. So I go back to the situation when I have resolution singularities. So in the simplest case, so I have this C2 divided by D2. And I constant its resolution. So this is T star P1. So the Euler number is 2. And this is a Lagrangian. So this is P1. And in one of the formulation in geometric circuit, in particular by Markowitz-Pironen, so you have one extra Lagrangian like this. So this is a strict transform. Then you count the number of reducible component as weight multiplicities. So this is 2, but I'm asking, I just don't consider this red component. I really studied this P1 and I compute the Poincaré polynomial. So then, so this is real 2 dimensions and Poincaré polynomial is living on degree 0 and degree 2. So this is Euler characteristics, it is still 2, but somehow by different reason. So this, those union of Lagrangian is Euler number 2, but this has dimension 2 in degree 2, but I consider this 0 section. So it has finally equal.
Yeah, and I think in this case, if you, if you were to look at structure sheaves of the P1 as then I think the homes between them equivariant. It's exactly the other characteristic.
Okay.
It is exactly the Poincaré polynomial.
Okay. That might be related to quantization of the Coulomb branchant, but I don't study the quantization. So okay, anyways, so this conjecture. So there was statement 1, 2, 3 in the original. I already mentioned that. So this is a fourth statement. So this P lambda mu Q is equal to C lambda mu Q. So this combinatorial object, combinatorial polynomial can be defined for affine algebra or even symmetric. So look at Moody, and this is equal to. So all these are equal. So this was conjecture.
So what is the analog of the P1 in this more general story? It's a Poincaré polynomial, I guess.
Poincaré polynomial of the cost of the intersection cohomology. And if you have the resolution, practical resolution, then this is just fiber over the fixed point. So this is a Lagrangian subvariety. But less irreducible component than the weight multiplicity. And this F still makes sense. But in fact, Slofstra, so I guess he was a student in Berkeley and the supervisor at Telemann. So in 2010, so he observed that this C, so this is A, this is B, and C. C is not correct. But instead, he used the different, slightly modified one. So instead of a single principal nilpotent element, you just take principal Heisenberg. And it's intersectionless, upper triangular part. So you express, you replace principal nilpotent element by the intersection, principal Heisenberg. So this makes sense only for the affine algebra. So once you replace the filtration, Brylinski-Kostant filtration by this one, then C is true. So okay, now I think I can state our result. So B so if I we replace F by F circle, then this B is true for affine here. It's true for affine type A. So we believe that our strategy works in general for affine algebras, but somehow but there is some technical issue about the Coulomb branch, and we can so far prove it only type affine type. So as I mentioned, this C lambda mu is some combinatorial object. So this is not given just by computing this intersection cohomology. Compute. So in fact, this combinatorial expression appears afterwards. So we use in our approach. So this combinatorial object appears through this work of Slofstra. Okay, now. So I go to the second section. So I explain archetype of Bezukhov-Nikov and Ginzburg. So as I mentioned, so I go back to the finite dimensional situation and I compare the affine Grassmannian and cotangent bundle, the flag byte in the Lagrange. Okay, so this proof of this C combinatorial expression and this Poincaré polynomial for the associated grade, this was proved by Bray and Brylinski and Breyer. So this is you use the proof used in finite dimension case, used the T star of geometry plus at the about left just fixed point formula. So there's not a torus action on this cotangent bundle, and you just compute the localization contribution from fixed point, then you get some combinatorial expression. This is combinatorial expression is exactly those combinatorial expression here. The only thing you must show is the vanishing of higher cohomology groups. So this is a point in the proof. But anyway, so the relation between combinatorial object and this Brylinski-Kostant filtration is given by the geometry of cotangent bundle and the softer strap.
Sorry, I just missed something. So T star the slices in a Frank Grassmannian T star G mod B only sometimes for some various
T star G mod B and Frank Grassmannian is nothing to do. They are completely unrelated so far, but because so far, I will explain more directly from now, but afterwards. But so far, I'm just comparing combinatory object and the cotangent bundle of flat by.
So I guess in type A, right, the T star G mod B is some intersection of slices under some conditions, I thought. So cool. Okay.
Yeah, but yes, it is, but it's not relevant here.
Okay, it's not relevant for the story, okay.
That's completely different. I mean, so how to say? Well, maybe, yeah, I hope you will see later.
Okay.
So he secretly used just a G mod B for affine algebra, affine Katsumudi group. But because of this is an infinite dimensional variety, so instead, so he used more algebraic approach. And so this Akbar-Bezirkovnik and Ginzburg, so they gave a direct link, more direct link between the affine Grassmannian and T-star geometry. So Q finite and mu dominant. So on one side, I constant this one. H star of L star I see around here. But I tensored with the dual of the highest weight integral by highest weight. Oh my, finite dimension simple representation and take sum over all the done. So this is equal to the space of sections of cotangent bundle to flat. Line bundle corresponds to mu. And this is G equivariant. Graded, I suppose. And moreover, it is compatible with this product. So on the right hand side, so this side is convolution, and this side corresponds to tensor product of the line bundle. Okay, so this is a very deep result. So I hope you should appreciate the statement. So one side, left hand side, is the cotangent bundle, the flag variety, and you consider the line bundle, and you consider the space of holomorphic sections. And this is vector space, and you have the G action coming from the G action of the flag variety. And this is graded because you have a cyst action on the fiber in this left hand side. And right hand side, this is just the grading. Cohomological grade, which I just asked. So these two gradings are compatible in this isomorphism. So as I said, there's no a priori relation among the cotangent bundle flag variety and affine Grassmannian. But if you consider those vector spaces, then it is isomorphic. And even more, so this is compatible with the product. So you can regard this statement so construct of the cotangent bundle of the flag variety from affine topology. Okay, because once you know that I consider all ample line bundles on the cotangent flag variety. And if I consider the all space of all sections and together with this multiplication, then you can recover the cotangent bundle flag variety. So right hand side is purely topological data. And from this, you can reconstruct the cotangent bundle flag variety. So this is very similar to the speed of Coulomb branch. So I recall in the beginning of my talk, very briefly about the definition. So in order to define a Coulomb branch, I consider affine Grassmannian and I consider some space. And then I consider that it's equivalent to Brylinski-Kostant homology. And from that, I define the Coulomb branch spectrum. And in fact, I also briefly mentioned that using Faber symmetry, you can construct Kaiser project one, not necessarily affine. So this is very much similar to the spirit of the Coulomb branch. In fact, So if you know the paper of our my joint work with Braverman-Finkelberg, so this is the third paper in our joint project. The title is Ring Object. So I started with the group and the representation, but the construction is a little bit more general. So ring object is a ring object in the derived category of constructive shift on the affine class mine. So this has a convolution product. And if you have a ring object in this category, then you can define a variety in a similar way. And in fact, so this Akipov, Bezukhov, Gimbus, they use the distinguished ring object. So you consider the regular representation of G check. So this is a ring object. In the category of representation of G check. I mean, this is infinite dimension, so you must somehow need to take a completion, but this is a technical point. So this is a ring object, and by geometric Satake, usual geometric Satake. So you get ring object in the derived the category of Berber sheaves on the affine class mining. And this is what we denote by A of bar. This is regular sheaf. So by geometric Satake, this is just given by V lambda star tensor with my sheaf, good lambda. G check. And this. I decorated this Kostok by blue lambda star. So this blue lambda star is coming from this blue lambda star. So right hand side is in fact the so in this. So this is a cohomology of this. Ring object in the category of progressives on the fungus. And in fact, this is also somehow very, I mean, if you know that the paper of Gayot and Witten, so they observe that T star of GMB is Coulomb branch. Of 3D n equal 4. Theory which they denote by T of G check. And more precisely resolved. For type A, this T G check. It's this quiver gate theory. So, and they say that this could be generalized to arbitrary complex deductive group. And this TG check is in general not Lagrangian. Quantum theory, so I cannot define in the usual way. But so we think of this AR to be the some kind of mathematical counterparts for this theory TG check. And if we consider cohomology of this AR, then I can define the Coulomb branch, and this is compatible with this observation. So so I hope this you feel a little familiar with this result. And the question which I asked this, the interpretation of cohomological grading of this intersection cohomology, is somehow really important in this statement. So this is this is corresponding to the sister action in the fiber of the cotangent bond. So our result. So this will be, so this ABG for affine loop. So this maybe I can so I'm not sure I can make sense of TG check for the loop group, but formally it looks like we are saying that statement. So this TG check could be considered also for the loop group, and we can consider its Coulomb branch. Then this Coulomb branch is no longer the usual finite dimension, but still it has its meaningful. As infinitely mentioned variety, which is cotangent bounded to flag variety for loop group. So this is our step. And this is somehow related to my joint work with Kofu and others. So this is 2000. So this last year. So we propose, not we, so this is related to our work of Google standards. So they propose to consider this infinite dimensional particular manifold as Brylinski tensor, and they can produce some interesting three manifold invariant from this. So anyway, I think this is something interesting to pursue, but I'm not sure how much I can say really rigorous. Okay, any question?
So just to make sure I understand the above, the Gayot-Witten's observations, like an example of this geometric Satake, right? So on one side you have this Coulomb branch from BFN construction, right? And in the other you have this other description. Discharging would be right there.
How should I say? So this, well, I'm.
What's the relation from this example to the above statement, this theorem?
So in this particular case, we can somehow firmly confirm their claim, but TG check. It's if you don't have Lagrangian theory, we don't have the usual definition of the Coulomb branch, but instead we can consider the corresponding ring object in this category. So instead of Lagrangian, instead of this non-Lagrangian theory, we start with this ring object. Then we can formally define the definition of the Coulomb branch. Then we get a T star G one B. So this is the state.
In this case, it is Lagrangian, right? So it is a Lagrangian.
Well, type A it is, but in general, no.
I see, okay.
So for our proposal in this ring object paper is that, so when there is no, when you have the quantum field theory without Lagrangian, then maybe we cannot apply our definition, but in some cases, we can assign ring object. And this assignment, we have no rigorous foundation because there's no definition of quantum field theory without Lagrangian force. But if we start with ring object, then we can consider the corresponding Coulomb.
I think, thank you.
Yeah, maybe I should also say that so return back to the original definition of Coulomb branch. So I started with some variety, and I take this the equivalent Borel-Moore homology. So in this setting, so I have variety R. So this is slipped in some. Subvarieties here, but you can just take this part. So you have the projection to affine Grassmannian for G. And if you consider the so-called dualizing sieve, this is very dual to the constant sieve. And it's, so you restrict it here and P shrink of. So this is a ring object. So somehow we generalize this definition to more general ring object. So you don't need to start with this this actual space. The only thing in our construction, the only ingredient which we need is a ring object in the affine class over the affine class manner. So when there's no Lagrangian description, maybe we cannot define the space R, but instead we can just define the ring object. That is our proposal in this ring object paper. And from this regular sheaf, we can construct the Higgs branch for the class S theory, which is mirrored to something, but outside of type A, so the something is not Lagrangian. Okay, any further question? Let me see, so how much? Okay. So again, we still in finite imaginary station. So T star of G mod B is this induction space. So B is a real algebra of B, A is a real algebra. So this H zero of T star of G mod B, from mu. So this is just given by induction, induced module. So this is a one-dimensional representation B with weight minus B. So this is so we substitute this description into the definition in the statement of ABG. So if we multiply this space with V lambda star and take direct sum, then we get to this space. So this is interpreted in this way. Then by reciprocity, so this is, we first restrict this representation D and C. Minus Q, and instead of G invariant, I take B invariant. So that is proceed. Okay. And this is algebraic. And it makes sense for Kavli. And Ginzburg-Riche, in fact, also considers the equivariant cohomology version. So T, as I mentioned, T acts on the Coulomb branch. The contrarian there of the fundamental group. But there's also sister action. So which we denote by sister loop. So this is coming from the cohomological degree. So this for finite case, this loop rotation in the loop rotation on the affine. So I can consider T cross sister of a fiber of the intersection. So this is, so Ginzburg-Riche proved that this is isomorphic. Maybe, let me see, maybe. So I first ignore the loop rotation. So instead of B, I take G mod N. One more geometric term, this is, so T star of G mod B is, so it is a fiber of family, some family. Parameterized by the real algebra of T. So this is a the universal deformation of the cotangent flag parameterized by the algebra of torus, and this is a zero fiber. So this deformation is given by the equivalent cohomology of intersection. And if I add loop rotation, then this is replaced by quantization. By Bama. So I replace this cotangent fiber by Bama. So I don't want to explain the definition of Bama, and strictly speaking, it's universal. So I hope you could accept this is a quantization of this deformation of the cotangent. Okay. So this is being spoken. Teach. So we try to prove this statement also in the affine setting. And in fact, the strategy is very similar to the strategy, in fact, the same as the strategy taken by Ginzburg-Riche. So this is given by considering the so-called hyperbolic restriction. And this hyperbolic restriction is in fact used in, already appears in the work of Markus Brunnen for geometric Satake. So going back to the situation of affine type, I explained in the special case of the resolution T star P1, of resolution of C star C2 mod D2. So I point a larger Lagrangian, which the number of reducible components is exactly given by weight multiplicities. And this is some general story. So you consider G character, so this is regular dominant. Co character. Let me see, maybe should I use T to be T check, and maybe I'm a little bit confused. Maybe I make somehow I let me see, let me, what is my notation? So T act is acting on the affine Grassmannian slices. So this should be, I think this should be T check. The maximal torque of the Lagrange theorem. Okay, anyway, so this T-check is a natural generalization of the usual T-check acting on the Laffine-Grassmannian for Katsumuri. And I take the regular dominant co-character in this, and I consider the following diagram. So there's a fixed point. And I have the whole variety, and there was inclusion, mu, but there's some intermediate space, A of chi. So this is attracting set. Okay. And there's inclusion. And projection. Then instead of the costock, you can consider the so-called hyperbolic restriction. So this is defined in the following way. Star by C lambda. You take a shrink restriction for here. And then push one. So this is the hyperbolic. And if you are not comfortable with this definition, as I said in this example, So if you apply the functor in this example, then you get to the it is the this Lagrangian, larger Lagrangian. The conjecture. So this is a refinement. The conjecture of Braverman-Finkelberg. So this P mu star of J mu shrink of C lambda mu hyperbolic restriction is concentrated in degree zero. This is A. This is. And if you take the direct sum, this is isomorphic representation. The furthermore, so in here EEEI and FY operators, generators of the real algebra act on the space. This can be realized by constant. Hyperbolic restriction. With respect to chi I, so this is non-generic dominant covariant. So contained in the root hyperplane floor. So this EI generated EI alpha is corresponding to simple root, and I consider corresponding root hyperplane, and I, instead of regular dominant covariant, I consider a singular one, so contain the root hyperplane. Then I can consider the hyperbolic restriction, and I don't want to go into detail, but there's some relation between the fixed point set with respect to chi I and affine Grassmannian slice for SL2, and using that this restriction, we can define EI and FY in some geometric way. So this realizes the action of the EI.
Is chi I some special C star action or?
Yeah, chi I, so you have this chamber, wild chamber. So chi is here and there's hyperplane, so this is chi I. You have other root hyperplane, then you realize chi j. So this is the dominant chamber. Okay, then, so you also observe so that H star of, so I consider the equivalent cohomology. And I just now introduced hyperbolic restriction. And there's a homomorphism from the upper to lower. So that is just a generalization of this, maybe So I consider the resolution. So I have P1, and so this P1 is of course contained in the larger Lagrangian.
Can you just, you said this already, but I'm not sure I understood. So you say that one can trade this intersection cohomology for cohomology of what? Just ordinary cohomology of the Lagrangian.
I consider the, first of all, I consider the resolution. And then I have two Lagrangian subvarieties. One is smaller and the other is larger. The smaller one is just by inverse of the fixed point.
Yeah. Yes. So whatever contracts to
the fixed point. This is the atractic set. And because I mean d mu is a fixed point, if you take a inverse image of the fixed point, that is contained in that attracting set. But attracting set is larger. I mean, it's clear from this example, right? So we are considering this kind of flows, hyperbolic flows. So attracting set contains the axis, the strict transforms axis. This is larger. So this is easier. And this is in the representation side. This is the weight space. In fact, you extend the scalar. So this is not just saying the dimension is the same. This there is natural isomorphism. It's respecting the algebra action. And I have this restriction. So universal gamma module. And that P. And in the representation theory side, there's also natural isomorphism. This is not isomorphism. This is an inclusion. So we ask this is.
How come you're always picking just one object? I would have thought that somehow you should have like a whole supply of Raman modules and something like simples. But you're interested in, you're always picking out one special thing somehow. I guess the-
I consider two things. One is larger Lagrangian, the other is-
But it's always a unique Lagrangian. It's not a whole supply of them.
What do you mean?
Or maybe, is there some sense where is this holomorphic Lagrangian a little like a tilting line bundle, which is actually like a sum of all line bundles, which generate like everything, or should I think of it that way? Maybe that's what it.
So you're asking about what kind of object correspond to in quantization.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, but I let me see. So in the quiver variety case, you can consider the two types of Lagrangian, and they correspond to the representation of the Cantor affine algebra, but they are corresponding to different representations, and one is what we call standard modules, and universal standard modules, and the other is tensor product of standard modules. So this is a little difficult to distinguish them. So both are, all those are free over the polynomial rings. And isomorphic, so this is given by inclusion, isomorphic over fractional field. So this corresponds to spectral parameter. And if you just take the generic spectral parameter, you cannot distinguish those. So if we consider them as a modules of a polynomial ring, they differ. And for some special choice of spectral parameter, they really differ. So this is something, how to say. So you consider the R matrix with spectral parameters. And so this R matrix is a rational function. It has some poles, and those poles make a difference between two modules. So this is something similar to this story. Well, maybe so if you consider in some special case, this is a representation of double algebras. And this smaller one is Berman modules. And the larger one is Wakimoto modules given by the embedding of double. Maybe I see double algebra representation. And upper one is Berman module. So this is universal. So I treat the highest weight as a variable. So this you have got the universal bar module. And you have universal Wakimoto module. And you have the inclusion. And if you take a generic highest weight, then universal Berman modules and universal Wakimoto, both are simples. So they are isomorphic. But if you take a specific highest weight, then they differ. Right. So this is a representation of W, and this is coming from the embedding of double algebra entitizing that. So we are talking about this difference. So anyway, I should finish soon. So this isomorphism in question mark, this one. So this exists. Over fractional field. And as I said, both us, all those modules are free. So it in order to check that this is actual isomorphism. So enough to check. There are no poles. And the possible poles appears only at loop two to the hyperplane. And so for Ginzburg-Riche, so they consider the all root hyperplanes, and there are only real root hyperplanes. And the real root means just translate of wide root, simple root. And the simple roots already appear in this construction of operators EI and FY I mentioned, right? So this EI and FY, so I have chi i's and by the localization theorem, the equivalent cohomology. So you only need to understand the fixed point with respect to chi i. So this is the what Ginzburg-Riche did in the analysis. So in the affine case, so we need to study. Kind of imaginary root hypothesis. Maybe I didn't kind of delta. Co-character. Contending. Imaginary root hypothesis. Then somehow, so if you consider the fixed point, so this is somehow general analysis, and this fixed point in the Coulomb branch is the Coulomb branch for Jordan quivers case. So it is known that this is isomorphic to symmetric powers of this type basic similarity. And also representation side, this corresponds to Heisenberg algebra. This is a homogeneous algebra. So once you consider the resolution similarities by taking Hilbert scheme points and the resolution. So somehow then you just need to prove the corresponding statement in the Heisenberg algebra. And we know very much about we realize that the Heisenberg in a geometric way. And then using this definition, it's not so difficult to check this statement for the case of Jordan, quiver, and Heisenberg. So this ends the proof. So we hope that this is a general story and the argument should work for arbitrary affine algebras. But as I said, there's some technical issue and we cannot carry over in general. But if we go beyond the affine algebra, then somehow we need to understand more general imaginary roots. Then the same analysis leads us to study the Coulomb branch for more general Jordan quiver. So we not only single edge loop, there might be several loops like this. So this more general. So in that case, I think nobody studied what the Coulomb branch somehow this is corresponding to the Higgs branch of the class S theory associated with higher genus Riemann surface. So I believe this is a very important question to ask, but so far we don't have enough technology to analyze those Coulomb branch. So beyond affine case, somehow we
I think we are long way to achieve this goal. Okay, thank you very much for I stop here. Any question?
Thank you. But you expect that there should be a good general story for any quiver?
I hope so. I mean, at least for quiver varieties, there's no distinction between affine and beyond affine. Yeah, and I also hope that the story of Morikon-Kunkov can have a mirror in Coulomb branch. So there should be some concept like stable envelope in the mirror side, and so you can construct the algebra in the same way as theirs. So you first define the R matrix and then apply this RTT relation to realize Yang-Yang or quantum. So as I pointed out in the middle, so there is no symplectic resolution in general. So you must be a little careful about this, but I hope many things still work.
And how bad are the singularities in, are they as bad as, for this license in the fine Grassmannian when you don't get a symplectic resolution? It's pretty bad. It's a really, really bad space.
Well, but I think Weeks proved that these are so-called symplectic singularities. So it is known that there are only finitely many symplectic leaves. So this is the first positive assertion calls in general. So maybe in future, so I hope, really hope that people can invent some technology to understand the Coulomb branch in general.
More questions? So again, the cases when you do have a symplectic resolution is just affine AN?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I mean, of course, if you are reduced to, I mean, if some vector space is zero at some vertices and you end up with finite Dinkin diagram, and then of course I think this is.
I have pretty powerful description in using equivariant mirror symmetry, which I think would work more generally. But whether you can extend it to cases which are not. Which are not mirrored to symplectic resolutions, I don't know. It's maybe possible, but it's, I don't know. So
in the mirror side, in general, fixed points are larger, but
what I'm talking about is two-dimensional mirror symmetry, not three. And this is very nice because it gives you answers to questions you really want to know, I suppose, about Coulomb branches. Like you can describe essentially everything, as it turns out, as long as the original Coulomb branch is smooth. And if it's not, you'd need to understand how to deal with I don't know, for chiasidal categories of superpotentials that don't have isolated critical points. And I don't know what's known about those. If one can make sense of them, then one can make sense of everything. But I don't know.
Well, but people do have good understanding in, even in finite cases when there's no syntactic resolutions. So if the lambda is a sum of minuscule weights, then you have the resolution, but in general, no. So, but even in that case, people do understand what the intersection combos are.
I suspect the question is, how much would you like to know about the theory? In some sense, these theories are solvable. They should give you examples of derived categories which are just solvable. They're solvable. That's the derived category of modules of your algebra, right? And we can describe them explicitly the way, this KRL algebras are known, and they're very nice objects.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. I suppose that maybe there is such a story just in complete generality. Maybe. Maybe you don't even need smoothness.
Mm.
Yeah, maybe. Seems a little too much to hope for.
Well, yes, that is true, but so far, no obstructor I observe.
Any more questions? And how about the story with non-simply laced? It's a different story, I suppose. But,
it's not so different. I mean, in the definition, we do have a definition of the Coulomb match in general. And we understand that there's no clear definition of the Higgs branch. So this is a Higgs branch for non-symmetric one, and I have been considering for many years, but I didn't succeed. But the Coulomb branch, for the Coulomb branch, is very easy. I mean, there's very, how to say it. So this is a, let me go back. So this, in this definition, the affine Grassmannian, I consider this G is a general product of nilinear groups. So for each vertex, I have affine Grassmannian. For symmetrizable case, so I change the formal disk for affine Grassmannian for each vertex. That is the only modification. So I have several disks for each.
How much survives of your correspondence with this other affine Grassmannian?
Other affine Grassmannian. For finite type, it works. I mean, this is true also in general.
So so the Coulomb branch will be intersection of slices in affine Grassmannian of a non-simply laced G?
Mm-hmm. Yes. This is what we proved. And for affine types, it's slightly complicated because you consider the instanton moduli space. But if the graph is the untwisted affine, then the Lagrange duality is a twisted affine algebra. So it's not the usual instanton moduli space. That is a twisted one.
Even in finite type. So do you just get an intersection of slices in affine Grassmannian of non-simple laced group on the nose, or mm-hmm. there's some folding action having to do
no
folding?
No folding. I mean, the folding is somehow implicit in already in the definition. So So I have GIs and GJs. So for each vertex, I have variables. And for example, so if you have, we impose this kind of GI, some power square, for example, we have this kind of relations. So in this symmetric case, all GI are the same for each vertex, but for symmetrizable case, we impose this kind of relations. So this is how to say, kind of twofold covering. And so this is somehow, I guess this is corresponding to the folding of quiver.
Sure.
And also that I think that I mentioned there is no definition of the Higgs branch, but I can consider the space of maps to Higgs branch from P1 to P1 to Higgs branch. So then since we are considering quiver gauge, we can consider several P1s, and those domain P1 could be different for each vertex, and they are related by coverings. So we are considering such kind of theory. So we don't have genuine Higgs branch, but we have very similar.
But at the end of the day, the theory on this intersection of slices in affine Grassmannian, it doesn't see any of the remnants of folding and all the. It just sees the roots of a non-simplicialized group.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. On the same loop space.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Interesting. Okay. Very good.
But if you consider the quantization of the slices, then you get something strange. And quantization looks the same as the quantization for unfolding.
Oh.
So as an algebra, they look different, but if you study its representation theory, then they are equivalent as the category to the representation of the unfolded quantization.
I see. Oh, this is very good. I see. But you say that the story of quantizations, it sees the unfolded, the whole unfolded thing. Oh, very interesting. Okay. That sounds really good, actually. Okay. Good.
So anyway, so these are explaining in my paper with Vikas. So please look at it.
Okay. If there are no further questions, let's thank Hiraku.
Constantine wrote something on there.
He says no questions because the lecture was exceptionally clear.
Well,
I think we can all agree, yes. Okay. Thank you so much for a lovely lecture.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.